impact? What were, there's any achievement? What were the records that we can set straight here? That were your inputs, your activities as a teacher that actually affect my life as a common Nigerian?
Thank you very much. Precisely like I said earlier, I joined CBN April 9, 2014. That's over 4 years ago, as a deputy governor. Then, at the time of my resumption, and just two months after my resumption, the current governor of the Central Bank, Godwin Emefiele, resumed on the 3rd of June. That's just 2 months after my resumption. The two of us replaced Mr. Tunde Leno, who was the DG, and the current Emir of Kano, Olaji Sanusi Lamido, who was the governor then. The two of us came into CBN almost about the same time, even I resumed 2 months before him. At the time that we resumed, this country was under immense pressure, economic pressure. And the pressure did not even start from the local economy. It was the negative impact of the trouble in the global economy, which affected a lot of other countries, not just Nigeria. And the major cause of this economic downturn or the financial crisis was the decline in international prices of commodities, of which oil happened to be one. And we know Nigeria relies for over 90% of our foreign revenue on oil. That's our major export. Every other export put together constitutes less than 10% of our foreign revenue. At a time, the price of oil went to as high as $140, and most of the time, $115, $120 to a barrel. By the time that we entered, this price has really crashed to as low as $40 to a barrel, and even came down to an all-time low of about $27 to a barrel, which means that even the revenue from selling the barrel of oil was almost going to be the same thing or the same amount as what was required to produce a barrel of oil, which means cost almost equal to revenue. So you can see that the revenue of government of Nigeria actually declined by nothing less than 75%. So we are having about a quarter of revenue that we used to have. And we are an economy that depends solely on importation. Virtually every aspect of our livelihood depends on import. And so obvious, even in everybody, from the glasses you put on, from the clothes you wear, from the shoes you wear, from your car, everything is imported. So we needed a lot of foreign exchange revenue to survive as a nation. And if your revenue dropped by 75%, the crisis was understandable. And it put a lot of pressure on the exchange rate of Naira to a dollar, to the extent that it declined to almost 525 Naira to buy just one US dollar. Because we didn't have enough flow from foreign revenue, because a number of investors in the country also were taking their monies away, and there are no additional inflow of investment fund into the country, it had an impact on the foreign reserve of the country. When we resumed at CBN, the reserve was about $29 billion. And it fell from over $40 billion because we needed to struggle to defend the value of the Naira. So the reserve was almost exhausted. By the time it got to $24 billion. Then the next thing was inflation, because majority of the goods and commodities that we purchase, even services, were imported. And there's so much devaluation in the value of the Naira, the prices of these goods and commodities also went up. The inflation moved from a single digit inflation about 6-7% at that time to about 18.7%. And to cap it all was the GDP, which is the economic output. We entered a recession. A recession means having consistent decline in the rate of growth of the gross domestic products of the country for 3-4 quarters. So we're having negative growth. So talking about exchange rate problem, talking about reserve problems, talking about inflation problems, talking about output problem in the country. It was like the heavens wanted to fall. If I'd allowed all these problems to weigh us down at the Central Bank of Nigeria, together with the economic team of the federal government, probably we'd have forgotten a country like Nigeria. And we did not. It challenged us. It made us to sit down and put on our thinking cap. How do we go about resolving these issues? That was 2014, 2015. And everybody could feel the negative impact of this decline in almost economic performance parameters. The common man could feel it. The price of goods went up. The exchange rate of the dollar went up. People could not pay school fees. People could not pay PTA. Even traders could not get funds.
The dollar was going to about 600 naira.
It was about 525 naira. And we did not stop it or come up with ingenious policies at that time. It would have gone to 600, 700. But because we sat down and sit down and we said, what can we do to this? And we came up with lots of potent economic policies, monetary policies, that we believe will be able to correct the situation at that time. And then looking back, I thank God that I was a part of that. I also played a major role in that. Today, the value of the naira dropped from 525 naira to a dollar down to 360. And it has remained at 360 in the last, in fact, for over a year now, it has stabilized. The liquidity is back. There are now investors bringing money back into the economy because of the return of confidence in the economy. Our reserve actually went down to as low as $24 billion. I can tell you authoritatively, it's over $48
billion now. $48 billion?
Yes, in a period of less than 3 years, we doubled the reserves. Inflation that was at 18.7%, the last inflation number released for last month was 11.3%. This over 700 basis point drop or decline in the level of inflation. It never happened anywhere in the world. That you correct all these anomalies in an economy in a period of 18 months. I can tell you that that was the role CBN played. The economy came out of recession. If you study the economies of other countries that went into recession, it will take nothing less than 5 to 6 years before they could actually
come out
of this recession. But in less than 1 year, we came out of recession, and our economy is growing at a positive rate today. So I would say that my 4 year stay, a little over 4 year stay in CBN, we were able to correct all these deficiencies in our economy, all these negative economic parameters that we had. And I'm so happy to be part of that team. And it has taught me a lot of lessons. It has taught me that there should be nothing like impossibility in the dictionary. When the situation looks bad, that is when you should be fully challenged to take it on and make sure you come out of it. If you allow yourself to be depressed by a bad situation, sincerely, you're getting more and more depressed.
And now,
it should bring out the man in you.
Yes.
And ingenuity in you as a team. So I want to thank God that my sojourn at CBN actually yielded a lot of fruit, not only for my own selfish interest alone, but the fact that there was a positive impact in the lives of the majority of Nigeria, which was also acknowledged by the president in his letter to me, commending me for the service I rendered to the nation for over 4 years.
Now, I am reliably informed or aware that you still have about 5-6 years to spend as DG of CBN. Am I right?
Very correct.
Now, leaving this position, why did you look at the comfort, the comfy, all this that you have, so certain, by God's grace, God help us, we live long. why did you leave that plumpy position with everything that you can imagine as a young man to disengage? Why did you disengage?
Thank you. That's a million-dollar question. A number of people have asked me this kind of question since I about public knowledge that I disengaged voluntarily from the Central Bank of Nigeria, because it's quite unusual. It is strange in this kind of environment that we live in.
Absolutely.
It's not typical of Nigerians.
Absolutely.
To do that. But let me tell you that everybody in this life was created for a purpose. And the moment you realize what you stand for and what you want as an individual, you never get it wrong. As a man, you must stand for something. If you don't stand for something, you will fall for anything that comes your way. That's number one. Number two is, everything you think of, that you do, or you lay your hands on as a man, you should not think of yourself only. You should not think of the comfort of yourself and your immediate family. We are created for different reasons. And there's a limit to the number of years you spend on this earth. We know what the average age of the years are before you die. You understand? And you only have a limited period for you to make an impact in this life. One thing that we always tell people is, make sure you overcome the financial challenges of this world. Once you achieve financial independence, then you should start thinking of other things that you can remembered for when you leave this world. If I challenge you today, that you tell me who was the richest man in the 60s, today you will not remember. If I ask you to tell me who was the richest man in the 70s, you will not remember. Who in the 80s? But as close as the 90s, you may not remember the richest man in Nigeria or in the world. You can only remember people for their riches and wealth when they are alive. The moment they pass on, you forget about it. Who remembers the Fajemi Nwokons today? Even if not for the political importance of Abiola's sojourn in life, nobody will remember Abiola for his riches or the world. But today we remember Awolowo every day. We remember Adelabu every day. We remember Azikwe every day. Tafawa Bamiwa, Ahmadu Bello.
Not for their riches.
Not for their riches or wealth. But for the impact they were able to make while they are alive. What impact are you able to make in your generation? This is what is passed across generations. Even for generations yet unborn, so far there's a record of history, of the role that anybody plays in life. So my decision to leave CBN is actually anchored on my lifelong ambition of ensuring that I make an impact on my environment, on my community. Because ours is a legacy. My grandfather, like you read out at the start of this program, of all that he did to help humanity, to help the masses, to remain the man of the people. Until today, even in death, he remains the most flamboyant, the most loved, and the most recognized politician to have come out of its valley and on your state at large. He died with £2,000, less than £2,000 in his account. But why are they remembering him? There were rich men, there were wealthy men in his time. Who remembers them? And I told myself, when I was writing my personal plan, 1991-92, when I was about to start my first job, I said, at the age of 45, between 45 and 50, I needed to quit any paid employment. For people that know me very well.
So you had the decision since 1991?
1991-92. I needed to quit paid employment and also become an entrepreneur. Who says we almost die in paid employment? Once you have had your fair share of a salary job, you should also strive to be an employer. To strive to be an entrepreneur. If you have been to China and most of these emerging powers in the world economy, they are made up of small entrepreneurs, not even large companies. I mean, to employ 50, to employ 100, another person 150, there will be employment for our people.
That's a huge sacrifice.
So that's number one. So that was actually my reason over 25 years ago, number one. Number two is, I feel that I'm in love with Oyo State. I have passion for Oyo State. Beyond Ibadan and both Ibadan City and Alta City, I've got connections. I have my deep roots in other parts of Oyo State. Almost all these means. We talked about Ibadan City and the Alta City before now. Mm-hmm. The city of 5 local governments, Alta City of 6 local governments. We're talking of Ibarapa, of 3 local governments. We're talking of Eruwa, Lanlate, Igbora, Ayete, Igongo, and all that. Mm. I've got my people there who schooled in Eruwa, for the Polytechnic of Ibadan. We're always going there then. My late uncle used to have a very good relationship with Chief Ogundoyi at that time. Mm. I used to go to their houses. Mm. So I know all those places. Mm. But when we're talking about Oyo, I have a family relationship with Oyo. The current Alaafin is that I had a strong relationship with my granddad. I even happen to be, they happen to be in-laws. Mm. I have an aunt that is a daughter to Alaafin. So I know Oyo very well. Where I go, everyone's like that. If I'm Okeogu, if you look at that book that you read very well, and you read out
African in Ebullition.
Yes, how they refer to the Adelabos, the Oriki of the Adelabos. They call them Omo Balogun Okegbeti because their own grandfathers actually went to Isei and Igbeti to learn weaving of cloths. Mm. So when you're talking about Isei, talking about Ilero, Okeo, talking about Saki, Aguare, Aguamondu, Igbo, Kishi, Igbeti. Mm. You understand? I also have deep roots there. Don't talk of Ogbomoso. Mm. Where I go almost regularly. So I have this passion for the entire state, which is Oyo State, even though I come from Ibadan there. And this is where I want to retire. This is where I want to live. I believe that you don't have to start going to Lagos. You don't have to start going to Dubai or go to London before you enjoy a good life. So we can create our own good life here in Oyo State. I've got houses in Lagos, almost all over Lagos. I've got houses in Abuja and every other place. But I prefer staying here in Ibadan. I can also tell you for free that in the last 4 to 5 years, in fact, that's in the last 10 years, I can count the number of weekends I've missed in Ibadan. I stay here, I live here. So why shouldn't I be interested in what can grow and develop my village environments? So that's one of the reasons I believe that the current, the incumbent government has laid the foundation, has tried a lot, has crossed over the line of impossibilities, has brought in security, has introduced roads that will last the test of time, has introduced reforms in education, has introduced reforms in health. Trade and investment are coming back in Ibadan. Nightlife is back. Security is back. There's no era of violence or illegalism again. So, but it's becoming more and more attractive. Oyo State is becoming more and more attractive. You go to Saki today, you see Dua Kaleju. You go to Isei, you see Dua Kaleju. You go to Oyo. These are things that you need for commerce. And I believe that this man can actually build the foundation. That he also needs people to take over the battle from him. And I look at myself, I said, it would be nice for me to also do this. A trial. From the family pedigree, is a political family, so it's in the blood to start with. And I've also made a profile for myself in terms of my academic background, in terms of my professional exposure. So I believe that I can come to Ibadan or to Oyo State and also try or fight for handover of power from the current governor.
Does that mean you have a relationship with the current governor?
I do. I will talk about that later. The second thing is a renewal of our family legacy, like I told you. We are known for good governance. We are known for the love of the people, and we are known for being grassroots. So, Adelabu died 60 years ago. The name still rings a bell. Even for those that were not born when this man died, they still know Adelabu Kwakyelamesi. But a legacy is like a drum that you get the kick. If you get to a time, it will slow down what is rolling. So you need another generation to give it another kick, so that the drum will start rolling all over again. So if people did not meet Adelabu of the 40s, of the 50s, they will be talking about Adelabu of the 2019 to 2027. You understand? Which is why I'm also interested in renewing our family legacy to ensure that our family that's known for good governance remains good governance. But most importantly, the president has challenged everybody that we all have to make sacrifices to have the Nigeria of our dream, to have the Nigeria that we can all be proud of. I see this as one of the sacrifices that the president has called on us to drop my comfort zone. It's a comfort zone.
It's a comfort zone.
If the focus is on me and my family and my friends, sincerely, it's not rational for me to leave the Central Bank of Nigeria. But it's no longer about money making or wealth acquisition. It's no longer about additional comfort. What else do I want to eat? Which house do I want to live? What car do I want to drive? To God be the glory, I've crossed the poverty line. And I will never go back to poverty because I'm an expert in financial management and I've saved for the rainy day. So I could afford to leave the stage for another person to come in. Now let me come and play here. I will play for two reasons. To inspire professionals like me who have been apathetic to the development of our democracy. You know, professionals are not attracted to politics. They believe it's rough, it's dirty, and the people are dangerous. I want to prove to them that I've been a professional of 27 years exposure. I'm coming to politics and I'm going to succeed. This will lure a lot of them. It will encourage them, it will inspire them to also join me. And when you have the critical mass of decent people in politics, our politics will never remain the same. Then the youths, yes, we have given the relatively old people their chance in history. 60 years after our independence, we have seen what happened. We have enrolled relatively old people. And we believe that it is the time for us to take our fate into our hands, to determine our own lives, to determine our own future. They used to tell us, oh, the youths are the leaders
of tomorrow.
That's not tomorrow anywhere. Tomorrow is now. If you don't take such step to take over power, it will never come. In the next 4 years, I'll become old too. I will have passed the age of 50. You understand? But if I don't make such attempt now, there can never be a better time. Even at 47, I'm still old. I may be young and youthful. Yet in other countries, you see 39, you see 42, you see 43. But I believe that it is better late than
never.
That's why I'm giving this a shot. As an inspiration to the decent professionals and to the youth to believe that do not leave this politics to the hands of charlatans. They determine your fate, both as an individual and as a corporate. That's why I had to leave my job in CBN to join this race. And I don't deserve pity or sympathy from anybody because I never consulted anybody before I dropped my job. It was a personal decision. Another decision I arrived at overnight. You understand? So, dropping my job or disengaging is one thing. Joining politics is another thing. If I had asked 100 people, should I leave my job for politics, the 100 of them would have said no. So why would I consult anybody? I did it on my own, and I knew the reasons why I do it. But in terms of politics, it's a different ballgame. I consulted in the last 3.5 to 4 years.
Yeah.
And the response, the reactions, has been quite encouraging. It has been quite positive, which is why I'm taking to what they have said. Thank you.
Ejansoyo, my dear.